Welcome to the Jacob Johnston Show. I got a good show for you today based off of fact-checking and online censorship. Okay, so I was watching The Rising on Hill TV, and they were going off and talking about these two issues of, you know, fact-checking versus online censorship and hate speech, and there was a couple of portions of this interview that they were doing that I thought was very important to touch on and talk about. So without any delay here, let's just go ahead and get into the first clip.
Another thing, Zed, that we're seeing is the insertion of fact-checking, right, within the platform. So on Twitter, for example, you can have fact-checks. Now, YouTube is actually doing the same thing. If you search, like, Joe Biden emails or Joe Biden fracking, there's, like, fact-checks from USA Today says this is what the truth is. Just lay out why that's particularly pernicious.
I think there's this sense. I think when Mark Zuckerberg and Jack Dorsey started those services, like Jack Dorsey used to say, I'm from the free speech wing of the free speech party. Mark Zuckerberg said, I think as little as a couple of years ago, we don't want to be the arbiters of truth. No one wants to put us in that position. They had a more kind of free spirited kind of libertarian mindset. But I think what happened is after the election of Trump in particular, a lot of people were pointing to these social services as a reason that he got elected, which I don't think is very strong. There's not a very strong case to be made for that. I think bigger structural factors with the election, the economy, and the state of politics is probably why he got elected. But I think because they got so much pressure from the government, they started being worried that the government would regulate them in certain ways, regulate the content of their speech, if they didn't start doing all this. And I think in particular, Facebook probably thinks Biden is going to win the election. So they're trying to do certain things, I think, to head off any potential regulation.
Now, that is an interesting take, isn't it? How Mark Zuckerberg and Jack Dorsey went from, we are the promoters of free speech and the free sharing of information and ideas, to, you're not allowed to post anything we do not pre-approve. And it's all based off of government, trying to appease government, and how the 2016 election really broke the Democrat Party and the liberal, you know, the entire left-wing establishment of politics. How they were so arrogant and full of themselves, and they were trying to explain away how they could lose because it couldn't be because of their crap policies or their track record of failure. So they blamed social media companies. They blamed tech companies. And tech companies took a look around and going, well, you know, Republicans, they're never going to do anything to punish us for, you know, posting information that they just don't like. You know, they're not going to do anything. So we must appease the Democrat Party. And so in order to stave off regulation or government takeover of their business, you know, and allow them to still have some control over the companies that they built, they decided they must appease the Democrats, engage in basically book burning to do a 180 on their whole idea of freedom of idea sharing and information. And it's interesting because, you know, this is what third world dictatorships look like, where everybody who wants to be successful has to kiss the butt of government. You can't be critical of government or allow anything critical of government to come out of your company whatsoever. And that the calculus being that, hey, you know, Joe Biden's going to win, so we must kiss his butt or he's going to destroy our companies. It is, you know, really a good take on it, you know, and I'm surprised because The Hill, I mean, they're not conservatives. They're not a conservative outlet, but they're not as radical as the CNN or MSNBC or NBC. They do at times promote some good information and conversation. But then we get into the question here of fact checking, right? How you see it, Facebook putting in fact checks and Twitter fact checks and YouTube having some fact checking on there. And it's like, well, who's determining whether or not these are facts, right? Because a lot of these fact checks are full of BS. I mean, they're not even really checking facts, you know, and it's, let me put it to you this way. We have people who can't tell the difference between a boy and a girl determining what is and isn't true. Think about how crazy that is. That's like putting, you know, the conspirators who think the moon landing was fake in charge of fact-checking NASA. You understand how insane that is. And, you know, when you take a look at these fact-checkers, They're not actually checking facts on statements being made. They're checking, you know, what their perceived idea of what the implication is. You know, they make up something that the person didn't actually say. And then they go off and basically try and fact check their own delusions about what a person is saying rather than the actual statement. And so the fact checking has just become another scam created by the left in order to try and influence or determine for you what you should think and believe. And if you, they don't like what you're posting or they don't agree with what they think the connotation is of what it is you're promoting, well, then it's false disinformation and must be eliminated online. This is dangerous. When you got a situation where, you know, people can't even agree anymore, or you got one side of politics who can't even tell the difference between a boy and a girl, going out there and demanding that they be the arbiters of truth and determining what information is fact, fiction, what should be, you know, suppressed or promoted, it's a very dangerous world. It's a very dangerous situation here. And what is the solution to it? Well, freedom of information. Just let everybody share. See, only those people who don't have any valid arguments and have nothing to back up their point of view, only those people seek to limit debate and suppress speech. Because it's the only way they can convince people to agree with them is by blocking their access to any other points of views or information. And it's just basically admitting defeat. Now, beyond, you know, the fact checking and why it is social media has gone from the great, you know, platform for the sharing of ideas and information, you know, and crap information gets buried. It never, you know, gets any traction. When you have to go through and, you know, alter the algorithms or have people go in there and manually suppress things, well, you're just admitting that, you know, one side tends to have more popular ideas that people agree with. But, you know, this whole suppressing information in order to kiss the butt of politicians, who, of course, don't want anything negative said about them, is, you know, just a dangerous situation for us. Now, the left goes off and they try to, you know, I guess they try to justify this by trying to make up words like hate speech. Hate speech. Oh, this is hateful. Oh, this is hateful. Well, what about hate speech? Well, the question is, who's determining what is and isn't hate speech? The left? You know, the left wants to go off and say, we need to censor online because we need to eliminate hate speech. Well, what's hate speech? Hate speech is anything we disagree with. Again, we come back to the point where we don't even agree, or at least the left is no longer able to determine what the difference between a boy and a girl is. And so they want to be able to determine something as subjective as hate speech. But if we take a look at how the left is and how they engage and, you know, everything, you know, have any public discourse, what do? They label everything that doesn't agree with them as hate speech. You go off and you talk about science and biology, you know, and determining gender, and they call that hate speech. They want to say, no, gender is whatever we say it is at that particular point in time. And so hate speech, you know, as an excuse, it doesn't make sense. There's nothing to back it up. Now, what the left will do, and I'm going to play this next clip here, and all that, they try to say, well, we need to change, you know, our speech laws to create a better society. Really? Does hate speech laws actually create a better society? Well, let's take a look at this next clip.
One of the arguments that I hear made against what you're saying coming from a lot of liberals is basically like, look, the way we approach and think about free speech in this country is different than how other countries approach and think about free speech. I think Germany is often held up as an example, and it's worked for them to rein in some of these fringe ideas and hate speech. What is your view of that take?
Yeah, I mean, I don't think looking at it empirically, could someone actually say that, like, Europe isn't is Europe or any of the other countries, because most countries in the world do have hate speech laws. Latin America has them, Asia has them, most African countries have them. So it's not just Europe. But I think, empirically speaking, I don't think you can say those countries are like less racist than America in any way. For instance, I don't think any European country has elected minority heads of state, except maybe, I think, briefly Ireland, or at least like racial or ethnic minorities. Most of them are much more hostile to immigration than we are. If the internet is a reflection of the reality of the public, you will also see offensive things. You'll see hateful things, at least relative to what you believe, because those are in the eye of the beholder.
And you know, that is exactly right. You know, all these countries that have hate speech laws, you know, it doesn't make them less hateful. In fact, they're, by all indications, more hateful and racist than the United States. Why? Because what you're doing is you're telling people what they can and cannot think or say, at least in public. So there's no public discourse. There's no sharing of information or ideas. And so it's kind of hard for public to change or evolve if they're not able to freely discuss ideas. It's a statement that goes back to the whole idea that someone convinced against their will is of the same mind still. You can't convince people against their will to believe something. Especially when you're not willing or not able to, you know, have lay out what the facts of the situation is. Here in the United States, it's because of our First Amendment that we are less racist, less hateful. We have more minorities than all these other European countries that tout about hate speech laws and all of that. We have more minorities in government and in control, you know, making up the rules and the laws. You know, hate speech laws actually do the exact opposite. Rather than, you know, going off and ending, you know, hate or, you know, getting rid of racism, they're just making an underground place where people just talk about it in private. Well, what do? If they talk about it in private, they're only going to talk about it with people of like mind. So they're just putting themselves into a bubble where they're only going to share things, our beliefs, our statements with people that they know are just going to agree with them, rather than having open conversation, open debate. Even bad ideas need to be exposed in open conversation so that people can debate it and then realize why it's a bad idea. You know, going off and just promoting stupid things and not allowing anybody to debate it, not allowing anyone to discuss the facts, evidence, you know, whether it's hard evidence or anecdotal evidence, you know, it just means that people don't have a chance to debate, you know, weigh all the information and come to a determination and evolve on a particular issue. So, yeah, when you go through and you take a look at this, you know, how we got to the point where we used to really celebrate, you know, across the all political sides, the First Amendment, the ability to freely share information, how the internet became the great arbiter and liberator of discussion and debate, to information suppression and, you know, book burning. You know, how did we get there? It's just like the same way of how did a nation that, you know, was founded on a revolt against excessive taxation become one of the most heavily taxed nations in the world? Name one thing that you can do that you don't have to pay a tax for, right? How did we get there? People stopped paying attention. People decided that, you know, we don't want to engage in debate. We want to ram our ideas down other people's throat, and we don't want to hear how our ideas are bad. So we're just going to censor all the information. And how did these tech companies go from being the great facilitators of debate to the biggest oppressors of debate? Well, because they became fearful of government. They became fearful of a tyrannical ideology, which is left-wing ideology, which is all about power, control, and dominance. You know, they became afraid of them, and now all we have is, well, the question is, I guess, where do we go? Where are we going to go to be able to freely debate? I mean, before the internet, we could only debate in our community, and our community was, by and large, like-minded people on most issues. You know, you may disagree on a couple issues here and there, but the internet was supposed to engage in large national debates. But apparently, I guess, when one side kept losing every single argument, they decided the First Amendment, freedom to debate ideas, freedom of information, those were horrible ideas. And since they were willing to use the government to enforce their censorship and punish anybody who didn't agree to go along with it, that's how we got, you know, Facebook going, we are not the arbiters of truth, to saying, oh, you can only post something if we pre-approve it. Twitter going from, we're the free speech wing of the free speech party, which was never true of the Democrats, you know, going from that to, we are the North Korean state media. You know? So what can we do? Well, I mean, the only thing that you can do is abandon these platforms for other platforms that do allow free speech and debate. You know, abandon Twitter and go over to Parler. That's a way to be able to get out of this. Abandon YouTube and go over to, you know, Rumble or BitChute. You know, start, you know, abandoning these platforms and start creating content on all these other places so that they can grow. And then we can replace these, you know, tech tyrants with people that want to facilitate free speech discussion. That's the only way we're going to be able to get around this. Okay, so that's it for this episode. I tried to keep the show a little bit shorter, you know, not doing hour-long video episodes. And I'm trying to engage a little more in discussion. And so just for future references, when it comes to these YouTube videos, BitChute, Rumbler, or Facebook, you know, wherever it is you're watching this, I'm going to be doing more of a mix between just, you know, going out there and, you know, just giving you my thoughts on a more serious note and mix that up with, you know, some comedy and some fun. So this is, of course, one of the more serious videos. And so just depending on what it is, I'm going to be switching back and forth between serious and comedy. Don't forget to hit the subscribe button. The kids, of course, they're starting to jump and bounce around. So that means that's the end of this. I don't know if I can edit that out. I'm not going to re-record, you know, because this is life. All right. So thank you so much for listening, and I will be back again soon.